invitation's been put out there, right? Jesus says, come to me. The Bible says that only by the Spirit can someone say that Christ is Lord. Only by the Spirit. They got to be drawn in. So the song is just an expression of what the Holy Spirit's doing. And He's done it. He did it for Justin. Justin, this past Wednesday night. Justin was baptized this past Wednesday night at in our vertical study, and I welcome you to come. It doesn't just happen right here on the weekend. It happens, you never know when it happens around here. We try to keep that tank ready. This is Justin's daughters, Madison and Gracie. Can you guys say hello to them? Would you take a moment and pray with me for these beautiful young ladies? Father, we hear your invitation. We hear your voice from heaven. We hear your Holy Spirit tugging on our heart. Lord, we're thankful that Justin heard the call, that Justin sensed your Spirit drawing him to the Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you for his obedience to hear it and to obey. Lord, I heard someone say in a song just the other day, let your word be louder than our fear. We all need to hear that. Your word is going out and it's calling people to you, but we fear. We fear losing control of our life. We fear what people would think if we got up and said yes to you. We want to be those people that just say, you know what, we're not ashamed of the gospel. We're excited about the gospel. We love Jesus Christ and we want the world to know. And that's what Justin did on Wednesday. He wanted the world to know that he loves Jesus Christ and he wants to follow him every day of his life, right into heaven. And because of his obedience, you know why his daughters are here tonight. Because they saw their daddy being obedient to God. And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that you have drawn their hearts through their dad. So we ask, Lord, for your blessing on these two beautiful creations, made in your image to be like you. We pray, Lord, that they would always have a gentle and quiet spirit that is so precious to you. We pray, Lord, that their salvation is so real that it permeates every inch of their heart, every spot in their heart, every molecule in their brain is permeated by the love of God, the salvation that you've given them. Let it be so real and so lasting. Lord, I pray that you would not just save them, Lord, but you would transform them into what you have planned for them, and that you would use them now as a light. They're going back into the jungle, if you will, back to school, back to the neighborhood with his kids. So, Lord, I pray that you would use Gracie and Madison as your agents, as your ambassadors for the good news of Jesus. Do your pleading through them. Give them the spirit of boldness to share Jesus with their friends and to never be afraid. Lord, also grant them this, that when they are fearful, let them know that you will never leave them, that you are right there by their side. And let them also know that we're here praying for them and loving them. Thank you for this moment, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Woo!
That is the question, isn't it? The ultimate question. Can we just take a second and thank God for what he's doing in the lives of the people here in this church? Madison and Gracie, can we thank him? I think he deserves that. Just awesome. What a joy to be able to be watching your children, right? Like, that's insane awesome. I had the privilege of baptizing my daughter, Adriana. That was a great joy. It's been a while, though, right? She's getting way too old. I don't like it. But I got another chance. I got Jackson and Jameson. I get to do it again someday. Praise God. That's going to happen. Can you guys agree with me on that one, please? Like, that's going to happen? Yeah. I like the way Dan was doing it. Like, a little louder agreement would be cool. I don't know about you, but I like noise. I want to just take a moment and just reflect back on probably the last 6 months of what we've been doing here at our church, just really getting to know who Jesus Christ is. I mean, that's really, at the end of the day, that's what we're after. There's a lot of sources out there that you can look into and try to find out, you know, going to Google, who is Jesus? You can ask Jeeves, you can go to Bing, you can do it all. You can ask your mom, and you can ask your grandpa, who's Jesus? But at the end of the day, really, the only thing that matters is what does Jesus say about who Jesus is? You know, it just doesn't matter even what I say. It doesn't make any difference. I'm just a guy. I'm just an unworthy servant doing my duty. I'm getting up here and I'm doing what I feel compelled to do. And by the way, I couldn't stop anyway. There's just no way. It doesn't matter what you guys try to do. I'm gonna yell, and I'm gonna tell people about Jesus. And if I can't do it here, I'm gonna do it somewhere. All right, so that's what's going to happen. But we've been searching through the scriptures, been going through the Gospel of Luke, just so we could see who Jesus Christ is. We want to know who he is. We want to know what he taught. We want to know what he said about you, what he said about himself, what he said he's going to do someday, you know, like all this stuff, right? We want to know who he is. The reason why we're doing it is because the scriptures tell us that we're supposed to worship him in spirit and in truth, right? And they kind of go hand in hand. So if you've been coming here for a while now, you've heard me say this, but I don't want to forget this. I want to make sure y'all get this. That in order for us to get amped up and worship him with some spirit, you know, like a cheerleading crew, right? Do you ever see the cheerleaders? They're just fired up about nothing, right? They're fired up about nothing. We have something to be fired up about, though. Like, ours is not a nothing. Ours is a something. So we should be fired up about Jesus. But the only way to be fired up about Jesus is if you know who he is. So when the reality of Christ falls upon you, there's nothing you can do except worship him. And so that's what we're shooting for here at Revolution. So we've been going through the Gospel of Luke, because that's what Luke did. He wanted to have a clear account so these people would know the truth, so they could worship him well. So if it worked for them, certainly it should work for us, right? So let me just say this. I think it was last week. I have a very, very, very bad memory, so just bear with me. But I think it was last week that I shared this verse with you, and it comes from John 6:37. It's this: whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. I will never drive away. You know, it's really, really cool just to show you that God is at work in his people. Last week I shared with you that I didn't know if our detour into controversial issues was going to remain. It might go another week or two. I didn't know. Remember I told you that? We kind of got away from Luke, and we're just kind of venturing into some highly contested areas and just going to face them and tell you what the Bible says. You make your decision, but I tried to do that again, and it just shut right down and just drove me right back into Luke, and Luke came alive. Remember I told you that that's how it works, right? So that same section that was dead to me is now very much alive this week. But this week, Jessica had no idea what I was going to be preaching. You know why? Because I had no idea what I was going to be preaching. And so she selected some songs, and unbeknownst to me, she selected this song, Come to Me. I didn't even know that, but the title of my message is Come to Me, right? I didn't even know it, right? And that's this whole section is about Jesus talking about coming to him. So this verse right here in John 6:37, we're going to be in Luke, but John 6:37 talks about coming to me. And that's very, very comforting, especially if you've been low down and rotten like I have. It's really good to know, it's encouraging to know that no matter what you do, no matter how far you've drifted, right? His arm is not too short, and he'll receive you, that no matter what you do, if you turn from that junk and run to Jesus. He's right there. He's open arms, and he's not going to drive you away. Like, that's super comforting, right? Yeah. That's good to know, right, for a lot of us. I don't know. I'm starting to get to know all of you. I don't know anybody who's just, like, sweet and kind. Hey, you guys want to hear something? I hope you don't mind. Just to tell you what I'm talking about, Nick here, he got saved at an Alice Cooper concert.
Yeah!
Right? That's just an idea of what we're dealing with here, right? That's a very comforting verse right there. No matter who you are, right? He won't drive you, or he'll receive you right then and there. But you know what? It doesn't, what do you mean by, like, come to me? Is that like, you know, come to the altar when the preacher calls you and say a certain prayer and all that? Like, yeah, I it could look like that. Like, that might be the appearance, but that's not really what Jesus is talking about. It might flesh out in that, but he was looking for a little bit more than that, right? He's not looking for the person to come forward. He's looking for something inside the person that's happening that drives them to the altar. You catching me? Okay, so this is what I'm talking about. Hebrews 11:6, right? So we just said, John 6:37 says, whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. So Hebrews 11:6 talks about faith. Hebrews 11 is all about faith. And faith is described right here in Hebrews 11:6, and it says, anyone who wants to come to him, there it is, right? Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists, two things. You got to believe that he exists, and you got to believe that he rewards those who sincerely, or some would say earnestly, seek him. Amen. So you got to believe these two things. When you come to God, you have to believe that he's real. Right? So listen, he's not a fairy tale. And the stories in the Bible, like, they're not just good little stories about these Bible characters that teach good lessons and teach you to have a high morality and stuff, right? They're not. They're not at all. There's more to it. You have to graduate past it. Like, that might work when you were three. Like, Jackson might not get the idea of a God that really saves from a flood, right? He might just learn this little story that's cute. But listen, I don't see any three-year-olds in here. We have to graduate, right? We have to graduate to the point, like, here, we have to graduate to Acts chapter 4, where Peter and John say, how could we not tell of the things that we have seen and heard? Not just read in a book from way back when, thousands of years ago, but, like, I've experienced God. I may not have been in the flood, but I've been in a flood and I got rescued, right? I experienced God. I didn't just hear about it in a story that doesn't really pertain to me. No, I've experienced the living God. You have to believe that he exists. He's not some fairy tale. Here's another thing, too. There's an 18th century European Enlightenment philosophy called deism. I don't know if you've ever heard of deism, but deism is not, like, super, super popular, but it's out there. It's pretty popular. Deism is this idea that because of nature, you can see that there was a deity that made everything, but that Bible revelation is not a true source of spiritual knowledge, and that once God made all this, he stepped out and he no longer interacts or even interferes in any way with that which he created. He's a far-off God. Now reach out and touch somebody and say, that ain't true. Come on now. That is not true at all. That's not what the Bible would teach us at all. Let me tell you what the Bible would teach us about this God. It would teach us in Romans chapter 1. If you want to, please, you know, you got to go. Go to Romans. Velvet, I've been telling everybody for the last, 8 years? Pick up your Bible and read it, haven't I? Yeah, Velvet was with me the first day I ever started a church. Right there. First time seeing her in years. Right? Yeah. There's Mary. Listen, that will never change. We have to put our eyes on God's word to know the truth, okay? I'm going to beat that horse to death until you open that Bible and read it. If you read it here, maybe, just maybe, you'll read it at home, amen? Amen. And that way, what you get here is just supplemental what God's already given you at home. That would be awesome. That would be awesome. Okay, so here's what it says in Romans chapter 1. This is what God really is. He's not some fairy tale. He's not some far off God. Romans chapter 1 verse 19 would say this. They know the truth. He's talking about all the people on the earth here. If you get the context of it, he says that they know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky through everything God made. They can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power, and divine nature. Now, pause there for a second. That's deism in a nutshell right there. Okay? But God's word doesn't stop there. See, because of what he did, like the deist would say, because of what we see, we know that there's a God. But the Bible doesn't stop there. It says, because of that, so, as a result, because, right? So, they have no excuse for not knowing God. Yes, they knew God like they knew of him, right? But now he's talking about something different. He's talking about knowing him, right? He's talking about knowing him. He says, but they wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And here's deism in a nutshell. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was. And as a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. See, deism stops short of truth. It says, because everything out there, you know that there's a God, but he's not here anymore. He's off doing this maybe again in some other place. Maybe some other galaxy somewhere, reproducing this thing because it was kind of cool at first, but we jacked it up, so let me make it perfect here. But that's not what the Bible teaches. Okay, it teaches that, yeah, we know that he exists, but then it says knowing God, worshiping God, giving him thanks. See, these are all interactions with a very present God. You can't worship a God who's not there. You can't give him thanks to a God that's not. Would you go into an empty room and tell your wife thank you? Why would you do that? Please don't raise your hand when I ask that question. You wouldn't go into an empty room and say, honey, thank you so much for that glorious dinner that you gave me tonight. Who would do that? No one would do that unless that wife was right there with you, right? I know guys, we wouldn't do it unless she was there because we want some credit, right? We don't just do things that are nice. Heaven forbid, right? Guys, don't leave me hanging up here. Okay. So we have to believe that he exists in a present tense, like right now, not distant, not far away, the Bible says. You want to come to him, you need to believe that he's actually right there, right in front of you. And you have to believe that he's a rewarder. Or I would just say this, not there, a responder to those who earnestly or sincerely seek him. That somehow he's listening and he's going to act upon this. If you come to him, you got to believe that he's there and that he's going to actually respond or reward your effort to get to him, right? And so our text here tonight is Luke chapter 8, 40 through 56, you can start turning there. I'm going to read a little bit with you here in a little bit. But as you're turning there, you got to know that in this text that we're going to read, 16 verses, this Bible truth about God, that he exists and that he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him, this is displayed perfectly in these stories by Jesus Christ the Lord. And so not only is Jesus like displaying this thing so we could all see what God's like, but by doing so, he's actually fulfilling Hebrews 1:3 that says that the Son, Jesus Christ, radiates. That's talking about from within, not reflecting, right? Radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God. The second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ, the Lord, once again, right here, proving his deity. So if there's someone out there that you know, or maybe you're sitting here right now and say, well, Jesus was nice, and Jesus was kind, and Jesus taught well, and Jesus was a good moral teacher, but that's all Jesus was, you're about to get rocked, because that's not true, all right? Can you guys want to read with me? Okay. Luke 8, starting in verse 40. On the other side of the lake. Now, hold on a second. I'm sorry. You know what happened, right? He was here on this side of the lake, right? He says, guys, let's get in the boat. Go to that side of the lake. So he leaves all the crowds, gets his disciples, goes in the boat. The storm calms the storm, right? That was awesome. Awesome, right? And then he gets over here, and he heals the demon-possessed guy over that's running around like a crazy man in the cemetery, right? Heals that guy. Soon as he gets done, what happens? Boom, let's go back in the boat and go back over there. He went over there for this one dude. Yeah. Awesome, right? So he's super compassionate, but now he's back on the other side of the lake. He goes back to his original spot, and it says, on the other side of the lake, the crowds welcomed Jesus. That might seem like a no big deal to you, that they welcomed Jesus. But see, there's two different types of people in this world. There's people that welcome Jesus, and there's people who say, get out of my face, Jesus. The people over on the other side of the lake that saw the healing of the demon-possessed guy, they all were fearful. They said, Jesus, get out of here. We didn't want anything to do with him. But these people aren't like that. Which one are you? On the other side of the lake, the crowds welcomed Jesus because they had been waiting for him. That'll preach all night long right there, okay? They've been waiting upon the Lord. Patient. I'll venture into this in detail, but expecting. Why are they waiting for him? Because they want something. They need something, right? They're not just hanging out because he's a snappy dresser. He's going to do something. They need something. So they're waiting on him. Then a man named Jairus, a leader of the local synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come home with him. His only daughter, who was about 12 years old, was dying. As Jesus went with him, he was surrounded by the crowds. A woman in the crowd had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding, and she could find no cure. Coming up behind Jesus, she touched the fringe of his robe. Immediately, the bleeding stopped. Say amen.
Amen.
Who touched me? Jesus asked. Everyone denied it. And Peter said, Master, this whole crowd is pressing up against you. You know, so in other words, everyone's touching you. How, what's the difference? Jesus says, No. Someone deliberately touched me, for I felt healing power go out from me. When the woman realized that she could not stay hidden, she began to tremble and fell to her knees in front of him. The whole crowd heard her explain why she had touched him and that she had been immediately healed. Daughter.
Amen.
Yeah, that's kind of weird, right? Is that his kid? Not in the flesh. I don't know what he's trying to say there, right? Take a brain surgeon. You guys get it, right?
Yeah.
God. Daughter, he said to her, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. While he was still speaking to her, a messenger arrived from the home of Jairus, the leader of the synagogue. I love how he reminds us again who this guy really is. That's important. And the messenger tells him, your daughter is dead. So there's no use troubling the teacher now. You see how some people just view him as only a teacher. You could touch your neighbor and say, that's not true. Right? That's not true at all. That falls short, right? But when Jesus heard what had happened, he said to Jairus, don't be afraid. Just have faith and she will be healed. When they arrived at the house, Jesus wouldn't let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, James, and the little girl's father and mother. The house was filled with people weeping and wailing, but he said, stop the weeping. She's not dead. She's only asleep. But the crowd laughed at him because they all knew she had died. Then Jesus took her by the hand and said in a loud voice, I'm going to get loud, my child, get up. And at that moment, her life returned. Say, oh, right? Come on. And she immediately stood up. I don't know about you, but God's kind of fired up about that.
Amen.
I see an exclamation point there, man. You guys reading that? God's fired up about that. He's kind of wanting, and what, look, Christ followers, what do? We follow Christ. What he's so excited. We should kind of be excited about that too. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty fired up about that. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. I'm kind of fired up about that too. Yeah. Her parents were overwhelmed, but Jesus insisted that they not tell anyone what had happened. Does God have your full attention? I forgot to ask you that. Are you totally, totally, like, laser on him, right? On him. Phones away, Bibles open, pens in hand, right? Okay. So there's a couple stories unfolding here simultaneously that we just read, and they're very, very much intertwined. Let's kind of go through that together, okay? So first is the story of this guy, Jairus. He twice it says he's the leader of the local synagogue. So coming from Sharon, Massachusetts, where everyone's Jewish, like, I understand what this means. Like, it's a big deal to not just attend the temple, but to be the leader of the temple, of the local synagogue. Like, there was a temple in Jerusalem, but then they had, like, mini temples all over. Like, there's the main church and then all its little satellite offices. That's what the synagogues were. So to be in charge of that thing, you're like big-time Jewish guy in town, right? Big-time Jewish guy. And everyone would know you in your village. They would know you're a man of power and prestige and position. They would know you. It's kind of like being the mayor of a city, if you will, okay? And so think about this. He's got a 12-year-old daughter that's dying. He's in charge of the local synagogue, so he's got this amazing history behind him of this Jewish faith that God started. God started the Jewish. He chose them. He gave them their Ten Commandments and rules and told them to build the temple the way it's supposed to be and the tabernacle before that and have the ark with the Ten Commandments, all this stuff. God's done this. And this guy is in charge of taking that faith with all of its power and history and passing it on to you. And that guy publicly falls at the feet of Jesus Christ, who is promoting a different religion. Now think about that. Think about the boldness of this man. Why would he do that? You know, if he does this publicly, he is to be shunned from the local synagogue. He is willing to forego his position. He's willing to forego any kind of compensation or benefit package thereof that you'd get for being in charge of the local synagogue. And he's willing to throw that away. Why? He must have insane faith in Jesus Christ. If he didn't believe that Jesus was Lord and that he could heal this girl, why would he be willing to throw everything of his life away for this? This is an amazing big deal to fall at the feet of Jesus Christ. Do you know what? He fell at his feet. Do you have, like, it's not just what I just told you. It's more than that. The word that this guy Jairus would apply to what he did was the, because he's a Hebrew guy, right? It was this word shakah. Shakah was this. It was the word for worship for the Jewish people. Do you know what that means? That means to fall prostrate, to bow low before, to fall down flat on your face, and that's, he's worshiping Jesus Christ publicly in front of all these people that he's leading that are Jewish. That's crazy that he would do this. Crazy that he would do this. But he truly must have believed that Jesus was Lord. And he knew his own weakness. And he knew his own inability and his faith's inability to cure his dying daughter. He needed something else. So while he's admitting his weakness and his inability to solve this problem, at the same time, he's acknowledging Jesus Christ's power and enormous, unmatched ability to do that which he could not do. That's what he's doing. Now, as a result of this, here's Jesus, and how does he respond? Now listen, God said
that without faith it's impossible to please him. And those who come to him must believe that he exists, that he's a present, powerful God, and that he's a rewarder or responder to those who earnestly seek him, right? So how does Jesus respond to this guy who casts away everything else that means something to him and falls flat on his face, worshiping him, please? He says he was pleading with the guy, please heal my daughter. What does he do? Because he's God and he cannot lie and he has to live up to his word, he does respond and he leaves where he is and goes with the guy to the house and heals that girl and raises her from the dead. One person clapping. Come on now. Right? Man, help me, Lord Jesus. Jesus had and displayed incredible, incredible faith. Incredible faith. I want you, Lord. I need you, Lord. All my eggs are in your basket, Lord. Right? He had faith that Jesus was Lord and that Jesus would respond to his plea, and he did. There's something in there. If you haven't got it yet, we're going to get it. Here's the second story that's unfolding right here. It's this lady. It says that there's this lady that had been, I don't know what it is, about 12 years, but the girl's 12 years old. She's dying. This lady's been bleeding for 12 years. Now, Bible scholars go back and forth about what the bleeding is. It could be internal bleeding. It could be a menstrual thing. I don't know because it doesn't say. But I know she was bleeding, right? She was bleeding. She was in really bad health. Think about this for a moment. If someone is bleeding constantly for 12 years, would you have the image of a big, strong, hefty gal? Or would she probably be a little bit frail? A little bit weak, right? She's living in a Jewish culture where if someone's bleeding, menstrual bleeding, they're unclean. You don't go near them, right? And they don't go near you, and they don't go near the synagogue because they're unfit for worship. Imagine that. Unfit for worship. It kind of doesn't make any sense that God made women to do that, but yet, no, okay, that's stupid. So that's why I'm not Jewish anymore. Anyway, not just that, but they don't allow you to have cheeseburgers. That's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. So and pepperoni pizza. So she's unclean, right? She's unclean. It says that she'd been to doctors and no one could heal her, right? So but she had faith. But she had faith. She had something stirring inside of her that was so strong that even though nothing could help her, nothing on this earth could help her. She's a Jewish origin. She's there. She's got this faith, this religion that's been going on for years and years and years, and they're worshiping God and all this kind of stuff, but that's not helping. The law's not helping. It doesn't matter if her dad was circumcised or not. It doesn't matter how much she goes to temple. It doesn't matter how many doctors she goes to. Nothing is helping, but she has faith to believe, so she pushes through. Literally pushes through all the distractions, and she deliberately, that's the word of the night, deliberately touches Jesus Christ. That means there was some intentionality behind touching him. It wasn't just like because there's a crowd, right? It says there was a crowd. So everyone's like pushing up against, like we're right doing this. But no, this is not this. This is on purpose. Tom, I need to get your attention for a second. See the difference there? It's not just kind of rubbing up against him. It's I'm doing it for a reason. I'm stopping him in his tracks. I need you to stop, Tom. I need some help, Tom. Right? That's what it's talking about. And so she comes. It says that she comes to Jesus. There it is again. But she had intention behind it, and she literally presses through the crowd of distraction. A weak woman. A woman. I'm not like I love my wife. I love you, ladies. Right? It wasn't the same back then. She's a woman. So a woman wouldn't just rush up in the crowd and grab the rabbi. Especially a woman who's bleeding. Like none of this would ever take place unless She would have this faith that would transcend all the rules and know that if I get to this guy, deliberately go after him, I'm going to get healed. Amen. That's what she did. And so she pushes through all the distractions, and her actions displayed her belief that Jesus, you are Lord, and you will reward me if I earnestly seek you. And so how did Jesus respond? Can anyone snap their fingers with me? Healed. Instantly. Boom. She's healed. And not only that he doesn't stop there. Now he stops. And now he wants to make it known. He's like, whoa, 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 wait, who was that? Bring him forward. I want all you people to hear what happened. So he brings her forth. She's shaking. It's God in flesh, and she's kind of freaking out, right? But it says she couldn't hide anymore. She couldn't hide anymore. And he brings her forward because he wants everyone in the whole community to know about this whole, he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. He wants them to know about this, and he doesn't want them to know in other situations. We're going to hear that in a second. But he's very intentional himself on making sure that everyone knows. And so you see, it says in verse 47, the second half. Well, let's read the whole verse. When the woman realized that she could not stay hidden, she began to tremble and fell to her knees in front of him. We learned what that is, right? Worship, right? The whole crowd. Now listen, I don't know how many people are there. But like, there's a lot of people in this room right now, but I wouldn't call you a crowd. Would anyone in here call it a crowd? Oh, nice group. It's not a crowd though, is it? Crowd's what? Big, right? A lot of people. There's a lot of people. So there's this big crowd of people. It says the whole crowd heard her explain why she had touched him and that she had been immediately healed. That's why he did this. He called her forward so she could explain it to everybody. It says in Matthew's account in chapter 9, verse 21, it says that this is how she explained it. If I can just touch his robe, I'll be healed. And she announces this to the whole crowd so that they know that God's word is true, that Jesus is Lord, and he is real, and that he is a responder and a rewarder of those who earnestly or sincerely seek him. And he proved it right there and announced it to the whole world in front of him. And now he announces it to you through his word. So we got Jairus, massive faith to believe, right? How'd that work out? Like this? Good, right? How about the lady who was bleeding? Awesome faith, transcending all the rules, don't care what people think. How'd that work out? Real good, right? Well, there's another group of people. There's actually two other groups of people. We talked briefly about the crowd at the beginning. That was a good crowd. They were expecting him. They're waiting on him. They welcomed him. That was good. But let's talk about this other crowd. See, there's another crowd. It's not the verse 40 crowd on the other side of the lake that they came back in there. They were waiting and anticipating and happy that he was there. It was another crowd. It's the verse 53 crowd. You see him there? Yeah. You see, that crowd laughed at him. They were different than the other crowd. The other crowd was like, hoorah, Jesus is here. Woo! We're expecting something. We can't wait for you to get back so you can do more of this amazing stuff. We believe in you. We trust you. We're bringing you our sick. We're bringing you our paralyzed. We're bringing you our problems. You're solving stuff for us. It's awesome. But this crowd's not like that. This crowd was way different. They laughed at him because they all knew she had died. I'm going to share a verse with you. You don't have to go there. I just want to read. I feel like I need to read this to you. They had seen something, right? They saw with their eyes that chick was dead, right? Yes. And so they laughed at Jesus because he comes in saying, listen, she's not dead. I'm going to heal this girl. It's no big deal. She's just taking a siesta. And so they laugh at him. Total unbelief because of what they saw, right? And Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. See, they had none of that. They had none of that. They saw with their eyes, this girl was not breathing. She's dead. This is what I see. This is reality. And God's like, nah, not reality. I'm God. You're not. I'm going to do something here. And so what do? They laugh at him. That's unbelief. They didn't believe that what Jesus was saying was real. They didn't believe that he could do what he was going to do. And so they laughed at him. So what did the crowd get from Jesus? Can I just offer you this? That they got exactly what they believed for. Nothing. They got nothing. Now I didn't say, listen, this is the setting is this girl in bed. Dead. However you want to look at it. So when I say they got nothing, did the girl get healed? She's alive, right?
Yes.
So that's not what I'm talking about. Remember a little bit ago I said that the bleeding woman had such amazing faith, and Jesus knew it, and Jesus knew that she knew that if she could just reach through the crowd and get to him, if I could just touch his robe, I'll be healed. He knew that, right? And so what does he do? He calls her forward and says, hey, tell your story, man. I want everyone to know that I'm a rewarder of those who earnestly seek me. So go tell everybody about it. Yeah. And she gets up and she does. She says, hey, this is what happened. I was sick and I was bleeding for 12 years, but I knew that if I could just reach through the crowd and touch his robe, I would be healed. And I am. Awesome. Yeah, yeah, these people, they had unbelief. And so what happens after he heals the kid? He tells the parents, don't tell them what happened. He wants to give them exactly what they believed for. Nothing. You get nothing from me. They didn't believe. They had no faith. They didn't trust him at all. And he gave them exactly what they wanted. Nothing. Nothing. Did she get healed? Absolutely. Did they know about it? Nope. Not at all. Does God do that? Does he give us what we expect? I'm going to surprise you. Paul said in Romans 11, who can understand the thoughts of God? I'm at that place right now because that's what I thought. He doesn't give us what we expect. He doesn't always even give us what we ask for. Because preachers tell you all the time that God won't give you stuff if it's stupid stuff. Because he has your best interest at heart. Right? Have you ever heard that? Anyone ever heard that? Raise your hand if you've heard that. Or something like that. Okay, all of you. When Israel wanted a king, it was not in their best interest. He said, no, they don't want a king. They need me. But they insisted. So what did God do? He gave them a king. Was that in their best interest? No. Was it stupid stuff? Yes, and he gave it to them. Who can understand the thoughts of God? I do not. But I trust him. Here's another one. You ready? Numbers 14. Going way, way back to Numbers. I don't know if you want to go there or not, but jot it down and read it later. Numbers 14. This is way back. This is when Israel they're enslaved in Egypt for 400 years. 2 million of them, like it was living hell. And they're living in this. The rotten taskmasters of Egypt whipping them and beating them. And you've seen the movie, make bricks with no straw. And it was just awful, right? And so God intervenes and he saves his people. And he sends Moses and Aaron to lead them out of Israel, out of Egypt, out of bondage. Right? That's awesome. And so how does he do it? He sends the 10 plagues. Like the Nile River turned into blood. The angel of death came, there's 10 of them, but this is only two. The Nile turns to blood. That would have been enough. But the angel of death comes and kills the firstborn of Egypt. And right in between all those people are the Jewish people. And your kid gets killed, but your kid doesn't because you're Jewish. Like, they're watching all this stuff, right? They're watching the Egyptians' cattle and donkeys and horses or whatever they had over there dying on the spot. But yet in the same, like, neighborhood right here in my field, my animals aren't dying because I'm Jewish. They're watching all this stuff happen, right? Incredible. And so they get out of Egypt. And then after that, there's this thing that happened. It was called the parting of the Red Sea. I don't know if you've ever heard of it, right? It was a crazy thing where there's 2 million people piled up against the shore. Like, now what? Where are we going to go? Because this chariot's coming to kill us. And what are we going to do? So God says, Moses, pick up your staff and tell the water to open up. I'm just telling you this because maybe you didn't know about it. And he does this, and the water opens up, and there's like a wall here of water and a wall here of water, and they walk through on dry land, and they get delivered. And then the Egyptians are like, well, we're going to go in there. We're going to get him and kill him. So as soon as they get in the water and the last Jew steps on shore, God says, done. Wham! And they're all dead. Crazy, right? And the Jewish people are watching this happen. Now, I was not there. I was not there. So maybe I have a little bit of an excuse to not trust God. Right? I never saw that. I read about it. That's awesome. I've seen Charlton Heston with the movie. That was impressive. But I wasn't there. Were any of you there? These people were there. And right after that, this is Numbers 14. Right after that, they're there in the desert, and they start complaining because they've not gotten to this promised land that God promised them. And they're complaining and grumbling and complaining about this. Israel is doubting God big time. And they're expressing verbally major unbelief in this God who promised them deliverance to the promised land. In verse 11, let me go there. Verse 11, this is what God says. In response to this, he says to Moses, their leader, quote, it's God talking, you guys listening? How long will these people treat me with contempt? Will they never believe me, even after all the miraculous signs I've done among them? Like, God's like, really? Like, what more do you need? And you treat me like garbage. You won't believe in me. Like, I told you I would deliver you, and I sent the 10 plagues. That wasn't enough. And I opened up the Red Sea. That wasn't enough. When will you believe me? It's so bad that over in verse 4, the people said, let's choose a new leader and go back to Egypt. Someone say stupid.
Stupid.
It didn't take much to get you to say that one. That's way stupid. Right? Hey, do me a favor, Vel. Will you stick your finger in the socket for me? Well, why wouldn't you do that? Stupid, right? This is stupid. They've been led by this guy, this awesome leader, Moses, probably the greatest leader to ever live, right? And he leads them out of Egypt with God performing all these crazy miracles that I just kind of talked to you about. And they're still like, you know what? Let's get a new leader and go back to hell. Can we just do that, please? So stupid. So how does God respond to that? Verse 20, I'm blind, man. I should have my glass. Verse 27, he's heard the complaints. Yes, I've heard the complaints the Israelites are making against me. Now tell them this. This is God speaking. As surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very thing I heard you say. You want it? You don't want to go to the promised land? Fine. And he takes his hand of deliverance off the people, and every single one of those adults that had unbelief died before they got to the promised land. See, he can't say, well, I'm not going to take you to the promised land, because God cannot lie. And he made a commitment to Israel to bring them there. So he's going to follow through. But you don't want to go to Israel? You don't want to go to the promised land? Fine. You won't. You'll die here. But I'm taking my people, for my name's sake, I'm taking them to the promised land, but you ain't coming. That's what you wanted, that's what you get. You get what you expect something, and oftentimes, God gives it to you. So God's word proclaimed to you, God's word explained, and now God's word, well, explained hopefully with some clarity, but now God's word applied. So the word that I think you need to really pay attention to tonight is this. It's the one word out of Jesus Christ's mouth. When the woman reaches through the crowd and touches him, and he said, no, someone deliberately touched me. Deliberately. There was intention behind it, right? There's a reason why she did what she did. And I just want to commend that to you personally when you're in your personal relationship with the Lord. But now that we're here as a gathering of his people, right? Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock, day after day, weekend's coming, right? We're almost done here tonight, but guess what? Unless the Lord comes, we're going to do this again next week. We're going to be here, right? The weekends are always coming. And where two or more are gathered in his name, there he is. And God inhabits the praises of his people. And he says, don't neglect the gathering. Why does he say this? Because he is here. He's here longing to meet with you. That's why he miraculously provided for this place to be built. So he could meet with you, right? So you could meet with him. That's why we're here. We're not here to sing a good song, okay? You can go to the Hard Rock Cafe if that's what you want. We're here to meet with Jesus Christ the Lord deliberately, right? Deliberately. Are you intentional when you come here? Do you press through the distractions that would cause your absence physically? Listen, when are most of your offers to do fun stuff? When do they come?
Saturday.
I guarantee you go to a church that mostly they meet on Sunday. Guess what they'll say? Sunday. That's when your buddies are going to call and say, let's go fishing. That's when they're going to call and say, I got tickets to Disney. That's when your parents are going to call and say, I'm flying in. Can you come pick me up? No! Why won't you pick me up? I will as soon as church is over. You laugh.
No, that's true.
My mom's going to wait if we're having church. I can't tell you to do something that I'm not willing to do. So this is not for me to be boastful in any way. I just want to, we're supposed to lead by example, right?
Yeah.
So my mom came in town last year. The very night she came in, I left with my wife. We left to hang out with you guys. Because you're my church family. You are my blood. The blood of Jesus Christ, right? You're my family. And nothing's more important than this. Nothing. Nothing's more important than him. I don't care if the president walked in here right now and said, me or Jesus, guess what? Come on, right? So nothing's more important than Jesus Christ. And so the question is are you pushing through the distractions that would keep you from physically being here? Because I can tell you right now, just being honest with you, I look around the room, and I say most people are not pressing through. They're not pressing through. Church is for your convenience. If I don't have something else to do. Now listen, I'm not accusing anyone here. I love you all. I'm just saying I don't think I'm the only one in the room that would say that's the church in America, right? Listen, we're Revolution Church. We're supposed to be a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. Can we work on that, please? Please, yeah, come on, you can clap, it's good. Like, really? Okay, now, unlike the last time we talked about this, when the next week no one showed, please don't do that again, okay? You sign on the dotted line kind of thing, right? We're here, right? And I don't just mean the members of the band, they're gonna be here, I mean the rest of y'all, right? Let's build on something, let's get a little momentum, let's get a little traction. So are we intentional? Are we pushing through the distractions that would cause your absence physically? But I got to also ask you this. Are you pressing through the distractions that would cause your absence mentally? That's way different, isn't it? I'm talking about being in here and eyes are closed, or if they're open, it's because you're on Facebook, or you're thinking about where we're going to dinner afterwards. No. What are you thinking about while you're here? Do you come to church every weekend like Jairus? And every weekend like the sickly, bleeding woman, admitting weakness, needing Christ's touch to accomplish things that you cannot? This is believing that God will reward or respond if earnestly sought after. Listen, this just for me, like I don't know about you, but I don't come here every single weekend like out of routine or to earn a paycheck. Like I come fully expecting God to show up. That's why I'm here. I'm expecting him to convict us of sin. I'm expecting him to offer us faith and to grant us repentance. And I expect when I come here every single week that God's going to save people while we're here. That he's going to show up and pierce their heart and save them just like they did in the book of Acts. There's no different. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. Don't just say, well, look what he did back then. What about what he's doing right now? Two young ladies got baptized tonight. Come on. God is alive and he's well. He exists and he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. Amen. Amen. I can yell up here all day about myself, talk about what I do and my expectation, why I'm here. I can promise you it's not to make money. But what about you? Is this really? He's already put me through the ringer in preparation for this. This is the first time you're hearing it. By the way, if you sense something here before we leave, I just want to let you know that we're going to be back here tomorrow at 10 o'clock doing the same thing. So if you haven't come in with expectation tonight and received nothing, you get another chance tomorrow morning. You can come. No rule against it. Same message. What about you? I'm not talking about your spouse. I'm talking about your girlfriend or the guy at the end of the rows on Facebook. Now, I'm talking about you. Why are you even here? Not condemning, but I'm asking you, why are you here? Why did you come tonight? So as the worship team returns up to give you another opportunity to connect in song, let me ask you this. Is there intention in your attendance? Is there intention in your attendance here tonight? Why are you here? Is it because, you know, we're in America and this is the South, and that's just what Southerners do on the week? We just go to church. Is that why? Did your husband or your wife make you come? Did you have nothing else to do? Was the promise of pizza on your mind? Why did you come? Are you deliberately reaching? Are you deliberately pushing through the distractions? Are you deliberately pleading with the Lord to hear from him, to receive from the Lord? How about this? What if God gave you exactly what you were seeking for? What if he gave you exactly what you were believing for tonight? What would that be? Are you seeking healing in some way? Physically, emotionally, relationally? Are you seeking salvation? Do you need to be saved? Do you need to be saved from the destiny that sits before the sinner who has no choice but to go to an eternal hell because of sin? Did you come here seeking something that would save you and help you? Is that what you wanted when you came here? Do you need encouragement? Maybe you need some peace. You know, just to kind of let you know that what God's doing. I want to close here in a minute, but talk about peace. So we're here Wednesday, right? And the lesson in vertical was this unafraid witness. Like, we as God's people need to be bold and share the good news with people. That the only way they're going to know and be saved is through your mouth. That how will they know unless they are told? Faith comes from what? Hearing the word of God. You can't just live it out. Like, that's good, live it out. But if they don't know why you're living that way, it does nothing. We have to tell them. So here's this thing about peace. Are you coming here for peace? Do you need to experience the Lord? I heard Lori describe it yesterday when they were over for dinner, that there was a liquid love that poured over her.
Amen.
When she was saved. Like, yes. Is that what you need? Because as I'm leaving the church on Wednesday night, talking about being bold and unafraid to witness, I have to admit, even I'm a pastor and I got a big mouth, I sometimes drop the ball. We all have, right? When
Yes. We
know, well, it's something we should have told, but we didn't. So as I'm leaving the church, we turn onto 19 to go home, and there's a car in the middle of 19, done, broke down right there. So I thought, so I'm like, honey, pull over. There's a woman in there. We got to help her. Pull over there. I'm going to push her. Get up in the driveway. Make room for us because I'm going to push her. And I get out of the car and I run over to the car, and all of a sudden now there's a man there. I didn't even know where he came from. And he's a big dude. And I'm kind of like, whoa, where'd this guy come? I'm like, everything all right? Everything all right? Yeah, he's trying to beat me. Oh, she pulled a knife on me and I grabbed it away from her and she won't give me the keys and he won't give me the keys. I'm like, whoa, this is more than I thought, right? All of a sudden, she cranks the car that she said he took the keys for, gone. He looks at me, he's like, yo, man, can I get a ride home? I got my wife, Mimi, and two babies in my van.
Wow.
Like, oh, Lord. What's your name? Ben. Yeah, Ben, I'll give you a ride home. Come on in. So I open the door, the slider, and my wife's looking at this dude. She's like, I'm like, that's Ben. He's cool. We're giving him a ride home. She's like, oh, he's cool, huh? Yeah, he's cool. And he gets in the car, and we drive him to my house. We get into my car so my wife can just jet, right, with the kids. And I get in the car, and we're talking about this. He's telling me about everything that's going on. And he has no idea who he got in the car with, right? So I'm like, listen, I said, let me ask you a question. I said, just blatant. I was like, how's your relationship with the Lord? And he looks down. As soon as I said it, he looked down. He's like, oh, it's, you know, it's all right. But, you know, I used to go to church, but I hadn't in a couple of years. Which, ironically, he told me he's been dating his girl for a couple of years. And I looked at him and I said, can I talk to you openly? He said, yeah, absolutely. I guess he felt like he owed me that because I was giving him a ride. I said, do you remember when you used to go to church? He said, yeah. I said, was your life a lot more peaceful than it is at this very moment? He said, yeah, it was. I said, the problem is that instead of leading that girl to the Lord, you put her on top of the Lord.
Mm.
And there's chaos in your life because of it. Because there's peace. When you come here, right? How many people come here? And when you... Like right now, just, this is not to brag about our church in any way. Did God speak to you tonight? Do you feel better about life in general because you came? Wasn't it good for you? Did you enjoy tonight? Like, you don't have to clap or anything. Was it good? It was good, right? I enjoyed it. Helped me. Builds my faith in God. There's peace. The question is, are you coming for that? When you come to church, when you get in your car to come here on Saturday night or Sunday morning, are you thinking that, like, Lord, I need peace. I'm coming to you deliberately for peace, for encouragement, for healing, for salvation. Maybe not salvation for heaven, but deliverance from some addiction or a problem. Maybe I need some wisdom. Lord, I need you. I need you to speak to me tonight. Maybe it's hope. Maybe you feel hopeless in a situation and you just need hope. You need God to speak to you and breathe hope back into your life, right? So my question is when you come here, are you coming with expectation for these things? Are you pressing through all the distractions that would keep you from that and just saying, Lord, I know that if I get through all this stuff and I come to you, I'll be healed. If I could get to you, I'll be healed. Lord, I just need to hear your voice tonight. I need to feel your loving arms around me. I need hope because I'm lost and I'm hurting. I need help in my relationships at home. My marriage is a wreck and I need you to speak not just to me, but to us as we sit here. I need you. Are you coming in with that? What does your attendance here right now say of your expectation? What does it say? Father, I want to thank you for tonight. I want to thank you for obviously being here. So as all eyes are closed and all heads are bowed, I'd like to ask all of you, God's people, if God has spoken to you tonight, if you have experienced him, if you felt him, if you heard from him in any way, would you gently just raise your hand? Keep your hand up a moment. Now, if you'll be so bold, keep your hand up. If you'll be so bold, everyone open their eyes and look at the hands in the room. Evidence of a God that exists. And that he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. You see it. It's not a story in the Bible. It's right here, right now. You came with expectation. You heard from him. And he'll do it every single week if you will come with expectation. Thank you, Father, for this night. We're going to praise him one more time. I don't know what they're going to sing. But would you just sing? Just enjoy singing to him. And then we'll take off. All right? I just want to let you guys know I love you very, very much. And thank you for letting me do what I'm doing. Be blessed.